You come up thousands of miles coming through Mexico, and we're going to stop it. Get him out of here. Get him out of here. Go home to your mom, darling. Go home.
Jeffrey Epstein, bad man. And Trump, bad man, because Trump and Jeffrey Epstein are in this picture together, and this is terrible because this guy's a pedophilic rapist, you know, or something like that, right?
Does Donald Trump just happen to be in a photograph of Jeffrey Epstein, or is there actually a connection here? In 2002, Trump told New York Magazine, "I've known Jeff for 15 years, terrific guy. He's a lot of fun to be with. It is even said that he likes beautiful women as much as I do, and many of them are on the younger side. No doubt about it, Jeffrey enjoys the social life." Epstein is a convicted child sex trafficker. His Palm Beach home was raided in 2005. Some of the photographs found in his home were so bad that authorities had to blur them out in the video. This one featured a child no more than 7 years old, bending over in a tiny dress. Even more interesting, video cameras were found hidden in clocks, and it's believed that he used those cameras to tape his famous friends in sex acts with underage girls for blackmail purposes. One of his victims, Virginia Roberts, said, "Epstein required me to describe the sexual events that I had with these men, presumably so that he could potentially blackmail them. I'm still very fearful of these men today." So who is Epstein running these honey traps for? Well, his best friend Ghislaine Maxwell was also involved. She was the one who recruited the young girls at Trump's Mar-a-Lago. And her father was Robert Maxwell, one of the most famous Israeli spies. He is well known for Promise Software, a program that Israeli intelligence stole, reconstructed with a backdoor, then sold to banks and intelligence agencies all over the world. Israel then had the ability to see everything important that was going on. They also sold it to the Sandia Nuclear Development Laboratory, stealing some of the most sensitive US secrets. It was Maxwell who was able to market it and sell it so successfully. Former Prime Minister Yitzhak Shamir said that no one had done more for the state of Israel than Robert Maxwell. Maxwell actually reminds me of Donald Trump, who Yair Netanyahu recently said is the best friend Jews ever had. Maxwell also had deep ties to organized crime. He was the one who helped get top Jewish mob boss Semyon Mogilevich an Israeli passport. Mogilevich was on the FBI's 10 most wanted list and is now living in Russia. He owns pipelines, he's into arms dealing, child trafficking, you name it. His name has come up a lot after Trump was elected. Former senior advisor to Donald Trump, Felix Sater, is a two-time convicted felon whose father worked for Mogilevich. Sater was also the managing director of Barrack Group and developed Trump Soho. He's being investigated for using Soho to launder millions of dollars.
If he were sitting in the room right now, I really wouldn't know what he looked like.
Trump and Maxwell have a lot in common. They're both in bed with the Jewish mob, they've both done so much for the state of Israel, and they both bought Khashoggi's yachts. Adnan Khashoggi is a part Jewish Saudi arms dealer. He was also a Mossad agent. He was outed by Viktor Ostrovsky in his book, By Way of Deception. Let's take a look at how close Trump's inner circle is to Jeffrey Epstein. Back in 2018, Trump's former chief strategist, Stephen Bannon, was spotted stepping out of his SUV and entering the registered sex offender's mansion in Manhattan. Trump's Secretary of Commerce, Wilbur Ross, was at a movie screening with Epstein just 2 months after his release from what was basically house arrest. Ross is the former managing director of Rothschild Inc., who bailed out Trump in the 90s. U.S. Attorney Alex Acosta violated the Federal Crime Victims' Rights Act and signed off on the non-prosecution agreement without notifying the women. He then gave Epstein a truly sweetheart deal, where he only had to serve 13 months in county jail, while being allowed to go home for another 12 hours of the day. Despite this, Trump chose Acosta to be his labor secretary. Acosta has recently resigned due to pressure. I'm sure you've all heard of the Lolita Express, Epstein's private plane where him and Ghislaine are accused of organizing underage sex parties. There's also a rumor that Trump kicked Epstein out of the Mar-a-Lago. Let's try to verify that.
I've heard the rumor that Epstein was kicked out of there for allegedly trying to pick up somebody's daughter or something like that. But I think I did chase that down as far as I could and never was able to confirm it. But I heard it.
So, Trump didn't actually ban Epstein from Mar-a-Lago. And Epstein's phone directory from his computer contains 14 numbers for Donald Trump, including emergency numbers, car numbers, and numbers to Trump's security guard and houseman. Jeffrey Epstein's brother, Mark, testified that Trump flew on Jeffrey's plane with him.
But when we do talk about Jeffrey Epstein, there isn't really too much of a connection between him and Trump if you compare it to Bill Clinton. Bill Clinton, their buddy, right? Bill Clinton, their pal.
Both Trump and Clinton were on the Lolita Express. A lot of the alt media doesn't want to admit this and will try to say that only Bill Clinton is a sexual deviant, while Trump is a moral man.
You know, I'm automatically attracted to beautiful. I just start kissing them. It's like a magnet. You just kiss. I don't even wait. And when you're a star, they let you do it. You can do anything.
Whatever you want.
Grab them by the pussy. I can do anything.
Pull the hell.
Hello, how are you?
I'm sure there's going to be a few people who think that I'm jumping the gun on Vince and James. Well, let's take a look at this. On his own website, he says that Trump is turning on Israel and is exposing their role in 9/11. Now ask yourself, is Vince retarded or is he lying to you?
And Donald Trump says, quote, elect me and you'll find out who really knocked down the Twin Towers. He's saying, elect me and I will expose 9/11. They may go ahead and kill him. I mean, you need to pray for Donald Trump right now, folks. And by the way, we need your prayers.
When the FBI arrested all those Israelis in 2001, did that mean Bush was exposing Israel? No. For the past couple years, when the FBI was investigating and arresting Trump's team, most of the alt media said that the FBI was working for a mysterious deep state. Now, when the FBI does something good, like declassifying 9/11 documents or arresting Jeffrey Epstein, most of the alt media says that the FBI is working for Trump.
And his DOJ just took him down. So I don't know how they can be saying that Trump is supporting this guy, this, that, and the other, when it was his DOJ that just took him down.
It was the Southern District of New York's Public Corruption Unit that decided to go after Epstein. You know what? Let's take a look at Trump's DOJ. Attorney General William Barr, who initially decided to recuse himself from the case, said, "I am recused from that matter because one of the law firms that represented Epstein long ago was a firm that I subsequently joined for a period of time." Kirkland and Ellis, the law firm in question, represented Epstein when he agreed to the infamous plea deal in 2008. It's possible Mr. Barr would attempt to interfere in the case, former FBI Assistant Director Frank Figliuzzi said before Mr. Barr's recusal, noting that the Attorney General's father, Donald Barr, hired Epstein as a teacher at a school in New York in the 1970s.
Good news on the Trump front. I did a video recently about why I still support Trump, because he goes after PEDOs. My family's over there. Jeffrey Epstein has been arrested, faces 40 years in prison.
Yeah.
Amy, are you excited?
Yeah, that's great news.
Okay, so I know the despair people will come in and say, it's be from...
Here are six people in Trump's inner circle who have ties to Epstein. What's Alan Dershowitz's relationship with Trump? Dershowitz, who's affiliated with Chabad Lubavitch, got Trump to release Rabbi Shalom Rubashkin from prison. A former federal prosecutor said, "It makes no sense that Donald Trump chose to commute the sentence of former agriprocessor's executive officer, Shalom Rubashkin, who the prosecutor called one of the biggest employers of illegal immigrants." Testimony showed Rubashkin and his team helped hundreds of illegal immigrants acquire false documents. During the raid, feds also found a meth lab operating at the slaughterhouse. Trump talks tough about Mexicans bringing drugs across the border, and rightfully so. But when Jewish mobsters flood the streets in America with meth, he releases them from prison. The female workers also complained that the supervisors would rape them in the storage room at the plant, and there was also children working there. Rubashkin systematically frauded banks, causing more than $26 million in losses. He then laundered the money through charitable organizations. The world's foremost expert on slaughter methods, Dr. Temple Grandin, told Mason City, Iowa's Globe Gazette, "I thought it was the most disgusting thing I'd ever seen. I couldn't believe it. I've been in at least 30 kosher slaughter plants, and I had never, ever seen that kind of procedure done before. This place was literally hell on earth. They would electrocute the cattle, rape the goyim, cook meth, steal tens of millions of dollars, and Dershowitz got Trump to set Rubashkin free."
Well, this is
I've
what,
gotten
this
guilty
is...
people acquitted of murder.
Dershowitz is a mob lawyer. Let's take a look at other Jewish mobsters he's defended. Israeli billionaire Benny Steinmetz is suspected of paying tens of millions of dollars to Guinea President Alpha Conde and his wife as a bribe for the granting of iron mining licenses in Guinea. The Israeli police said, "The evidence and the development of the investigation indicate that the benefit Steinmetz is suspected of having obtained through bribery amounts to $5 billion. He's also suspected of money laundering." Dershowitz also defended another Israeli billionaire, Dan Gertler, who amassed his fortune through hundreds of millions of dollars worth of corrupt mining and oil deals in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. Gertler has used his close friendship with DRC President Joseph Kabila to act as a middleman for mining asset sales in the DRC, requiring some multinational companies to go through Gertler to do business with the Congolese state. As a result, between 2010 and 2012 alone, the DRC reportedly lost over $1.36 billion in revenues from the underpricing of mining assets. Just like how Israel bribes politicians in America to get billions of dollars every year, they also bribe politicians in Africa, making billions of dollars exploiting the natural resources, arming both sides of a war, then millions of Africans end up fleeing to Europe. Dershowitz is a Mossad asset. One of his jobs is to put out Israeli propaganda, claiming that Palestinians die because Hamas is using them as human shields.
The Israeli army has been accused of using Palestinians, including children, as human shields during an operation in the West Bank. One case caught on camera by an Israeli human rights group appears to show Israeli soldiers forcing a Palestinian to go with them as they searched house to house in the West Bank town of Nablus. Another alleged victim who spoke to the BBC was just 11 years old.
"They had their weapons pointed at me. I was so afraid that the soldiers might do what they threatened, take me to jail or shoot me."
"I want to ask you, are these men being detained?"
"Yes."
You can't use them as human shields. This is a war crime. You know that, right?
"Not as a human shield. We're not
They're standing in front of your Jeep. That's not a human shield?
No.
How is that not?
عرفته عرفته ولد صغير ولد صغير ولد صغير من دار ربيع استنى صوره سلام عشان ماسكينه دلع سلام سلام
هذا فاكا
what the fuck
فاك يوم مزا يبقى ابوك عرس
ابدا من قدامي
Palestinians just want people to accept their very simple demands. And those demands are that every Jew and Christian be murdered according to the Quran. Oh, sweet Palestine. Oh, 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 sweet Palestine.
Now, let's look into what Palm Beach Police Chief Michael Rader and Detective Joseph Ricari had to say about this case. Word got back to Epstein that some of the girls had been questioned by police. Epstein then hired Alan Dershowitz. Alan Dershowitz flew down and met privately with Palm Beach State Attorney Barry Krischer, Ricari said. And the shenanigans that happened? I don't think I've ever seen or heard of before. Krischer began to dodge Ricari and Rader's phone calls and emails, and they dragged their feet on approving subpoenas. Early on, it became clear that things had changed, from Krischer saying, "We'll put this guy away for life," to, "These are all the reasons why we aren't going to prosecute this," Rader said.
The U.S. Attorney's Office got involved with this case with Jeffrey Epstein's A-list of defense attorneys that are extremely well known and extremely powerful. I think these attorneys were able to manipulate the sitting U.S. attorney and the assistant U.S. attorney working the cases. A few things happened in this case that during my law enforcement career I've never seen before. The U.S. attorneys here had an indictment and they were sending it back and forth to Jeffrey's lawyers for changes. Never seen anything like that before.
Epstein hired somebody that would impress the state attorney, Barry Krischer, to drop the investigation.
It became apparent to me that some of our evidence was being leaked to Epstein's lawyers, who began to question everything that we had in our probable cause affidavit, Rader said. The day of the search, on October 20, 2005, they found that most of Epstein's computer hard drives, surveillance cameras, and videos had been removed from the house, leaving loose, dangling wires, according to the police report. Dershowitz wrote in a letter to Ricari, "Our investigation had discovered at least one of her websites, and I am enclosing some examples." The site goes on to detail, including photos, her apparent fascination with marijuana. Ricari responded, "His attorney showed us a MySpace page where one of the girls was holding a beer in her hand, and they said, 'Oh look, she is underage drinking.'" Well, tell me what teenager doesn't. Does that mean she isn't a victim because she drank a beer? Basically, what you're telling me is, the only victim of sexual battery could be a nun. According to Dershowitz, we shouldn't take the girls seriously because they smoked weed or drank beer. But then why should we believe Dershowitz when he's the one getting guilty people acquitted of murder?
Well, this is
I've gotten this is guilty people acquitted of murder.
Mm-hmm. They had a very weak case. They had to rely on the word of witnesses who had long records of lying.
In May 2006, Rader wrote a letter which was released to the news media, calling on Krischer to remove himself from the case. Rader, Ricari, and the victims were being stalked by private investigators, who were most likely Mossad. Ricari just happened to die at a fairly young age. Kenneth Starr, who Epstein hired to defend him against charges that he sexually abused girls, was also the one who uncovered Bill Clinton's sexual relationship with Monica Lewinsky. In March 1999, British author Gordon Thomas released a book, Gideon's Spies, which alleged that Israel had blackmailed the Clinton administration with the threat to release tapped telephone conversations between the president and Monica Lewinsky to force Washington to abandon the mega hunt. In her testimony before independent counsel Kenneth Starr, Lewinsky said that the president had warned her on March 29, 1997, at the height of the mega hunt, that he suspected the White House telephones were being tapped by agents of an unnamed foreign country. And U.S. intelligence officials suspect Bibi Netanyahu of activating MEGA, the Israeli spy ring. Clinton basically admitted that Bibi blackmailed him. He said, "Bibi knows how to hit people where they're tender."
I was young, I was scared, I knew these people were powerful, I didn't know what would happen if I said no. I didn't know what would happen if I reported them. That 16-year-old girl just let it happen. And that was how I got into the abuse with Jeffrey and Gillen.
Virginia Roberts was working in the spa at Donald Trump's Mar-a-Lago Club in Palm Beach when British socialite Ghislaine Maxwell introduced her to multimillionaire Jeffrey Epstein.
The training started immediately. I mean, it was everything down to how to give a blowjob, how to be quiet, be subservient, give Jeffrey what he wants. A lot of this training came from Ghislaine herself. And being a woman, it kind of surprises you that a woman could actually let stuff like that happen, but not only let it happen, but to groom you into doing it. And then there's Jeffrey, who's telling you, "I want it this way, no, go slower, and don't do that, and do this." You're just thrown into a world that you don't understand, and you don't know how to, you're screaming on the inside and you don't know how to let it come out, and you just become this numb figure who refuses to feel and refuses to speak and refuses, all you do is obey, that's it. And eventually it led to, well, now we're gonna experiment and we're gonna try you with another guy and see how you go. So they sent me to an island with a professor, and I basically had to do what I did for Jeffrey for him. So it's very private. It's the perfect world for a billionaire getting away with what he was doing. He could hold big parties there and have huge orgies there, and nobody would have any idea what was going on because it was so quiet and so protected. And it started with one, and then it trickled into two, and then so on and so forth. And, you know, before you know it, I'm being lent out to politicians and to academics and to people that you, royalty.
Roberts claimed in an affidavit the two of the men that Epstein lent her out to were attorney Alan Dershowitz and Prince Andrew, the Duke of York.
There's another girl who backs up Virginia Roberts' claims about Dershowitz. Maria Farmer, now 49, worked in Epstein's apartment acquiring artwork, and she said she saw numerous young girls come to the house, some of them still wearing their school uniforms. She also saw Dershowitz there and said that he would go upstairs where the girls were led. Epstein arranged for Farmer to work on an art project at the Ohio mansion of his friend, Israeli billionaire Leslie Wexner. At one point, Epstein and Maxwell came for a visit and sexually assaulted Farmer, she says in the affidavit. MEGA, the Israeli spy ring, was founded in 1991 by Wexner. There's not much evidence indicating where Epstein got his wealth from. The bulk of Epstein's wealth is believed to come from his money management firm for 10-figure investors, although his only known client is Victoria's Secret founder, Les Wexner. Executives sued financiers, discussed how absent Epstein was from the field. He's supposed to run an enormous FX trading firm, said Enrique Diaz Alvarez, chief risk officer at Iberi. But I never once heard of him or his firm or anyone who worked or traded with him. And as Forbes wrote in a 2010 blog post with a very direct title, sex offender Jeffrey Epstein is not a billionaire. His money management firm based in the US Virgin Islands generates no public records, nor has his client list ever been released. But even the real estate holdings have an air of mystery to them. Epstein purchased or received the Manhattan townhouse from Wexner around 1998, but there were no property records on the mansion's transfer until 2011, when the company Wexner used to buy the place transferred it to an Epstein-owned company for $0. Epstein signed the document for both sides. Les Wexner founded Mega, the Israeli spy ring. Wexner was a Mossad agent who financed Epstein to run the sexual blackmail operation.
My daughter serves in the Mossad, Mr. Godman. Do you know what their motto is? B'tachabolo, ta'asalacha, milchama. By deception, we will do war.
The other person who founded Mega was Jewish mobster Charles Bronfman, owner of Seagram's, whose family made their fortune from Prohibition.
If you take a look at Prohibition, which was in the 20s, 50% of the leading bootleggers, not the guys who are making some gin in their bathtub, but the leading ones, you know, the top men, half of them were Jewish.
The Israeli media describes Charles Bronfman as a foreign donor who reshaped Israel. He also founded Birthright alongside casino mogul and Jewish mob boss Sheldon Adelson, who is Trump's biggest financier. CBC calls Adelson the godfather. He finances Trump and Israeli dictator Bibi Netanyahu. He also financed former Canadian Prime Minister Stephen Harper. In May 2001, a mega group meeting took place at the Manhattan mansion of Edgar Bronfman Sr., Charles's brother, who also donated many times to Israel. He served as the president of the World Jewish Congress, where he is remembered for helping bring Soviet Jews to Israel, just like Robert Maxwell did. His son, Edgar Bronfman Jr., former chairman of Warner Music Group, is also in Jeffrey Epstein's Little Black Book. And his sister, Claire Bronfman, recently pleaded guilty in the NXIVM case, admitting she held sex slaves. She faces 25 years, but it looks like she'll only serve 21 months. And Roger Stone, Trump's former advisor, was also a lobbyist for NXIVM. Now, we'll look at Trump's mentor, Roy Cohn, who was also a pedophile.
For Roger, with fond memories and the highest regard and affection for his good work in the 1980 campaign from a good friend, Roy Cohn.
Roger Stone, who idolized Roy Cohn, said, "Roy was not gay. He was a man who liked having sex with men. Gays were weak, effeminate. He always seemed to have these young blonde boys around. It just wasn't discussed. He was interested in power and access." Roy Cohn's own cousin, David Marcus, said, "Donald fit the pattern of the hangers-on and the disciples around Roy. He was tall and blonde and frankly, uber Gentile. Something about Roy's self-hating Jewish persona drove him to fair-haired boys. And at these parties, there was a bevy of blonde guys, almost Midwestern, and Donald Trump was paying homage to Roy. I wondered then if Roy was attracted to him." I could elaborate more on Roy Cohn and Roger Stone, but they deserve their own episode, and I'll make it if I'm still alive. Another pedophile in Trump's inner circle is Tafiq Arif, founder of Bayrock Group, who developed Trump Soho with Felix Sater. Both Sater and Arif are are affiliated with Chabad Lubavitch. Arif is also dubbed David by his people. Arif and Jewish oligarch Alexander Moshkevich were arrested on a yacht in Turkey with prostitutes as young as 13 years old. Moshkevich leased the yacht and Arif provided the girls. The women were told by their leaders not to speak or testify. The Turkish police suggested they get help from the Russian embassy, contact a Russian-speaking lawyer or their families, but they refused. "Don't testify, any of you," said a text message they received. "Everything is falling apart. Don't sign anything. They are out of control and have no power. You will soon be home."
Move! Move! Ganes, ganes, no!
No, don't worry. I don't expect you to do anything you don't want to do. Just talk to them, listen to what they have to say, and then we will send you home.
Alexander Moshkevich, founder of the Eurasian Jewish Congress, owns privatized and natural resources in Eastern Europe, Central Asia, and Africa. He's also a major donor to the State of Israel. One of his entourage describes him as an enthusiastic Jew and Zionist. He also donates significantly for synagogue construction in Russia. Trump is deep in bed with the mob, and many of his friends have 13-year-old Ukrainian and Russian prostitutes trapped in Israel. This is a big part of the mob's business, and it's a multi-billion dollar industry in Israel that Trump turns a blind eye to.
A large number of the Russian oligarchs were Jewish, so they could therefore get an Israeli passport. And the Israeli banking system, indeed the Israeli system as a whole, is designed to encourage immigration by Jews from the outside. But Israel had never seen anything like the immigration between 1990 and 2000 of Russians into Israel. About 1 million of them, that's 15% of Israel's population. And the police force in Israel, which is, you know, its resources tend to be devoted towards the Palestinian issue, had no idea what was going on when these Russians came in. They brought in a lot of money, which they used Israeli banks to launder it through, and they brought in some of their organized crime entourages. And Israel, which was also beginning to feel the impact of globalization, became an important area of organized crime in the region. At the same time, I mean, I have to say that this is, if for example, it's become one of the main countries that receives trafficked women for prostitution from all over the world, although largely from the former Soviet Union.
Trump also donated to Chabad Lubavitch, a messianic ultra-Orthodox organization where pedophilia is rampant. Remember Shalom Rubashkin, who Trump released from prison? Well, his son-in-law, Chabad Rabbi Yaakov Weiss, pleaded guilty to sexually molesting two boys as young as 13. And he told one of the boys to lie to their mother about what happened. For decades, Jewish boys were being raped by Chabad rabbis, and now they are speaking out. The Australian Chabad community has faced accusations of letting or even helping child molestation suspects get out of the country and into Israel or the US instead of turning them over to law enforcement authorities. Not only do these men escape punishment, but they are then capable of abusing new victims. Chabad operates in the US, and for that matter, all over the world. But it forms a nearly inescapable network in Australian Jewish life, according to Wax. As hard as it is for victims of sexual abuse to ever come forward, Wax believes it is even harder for Australian Jews because of Chabad's strength. In Australia, the Chabad community dominates the rabbinic scene. The vast majority of rabbis serving the country are from Chabad. The yeshivas are connected through Chabad. If you go up against an individual rabbi, you're up against the entire system, Wax said. I'll show you more examples where Chabad rabbis downplay pedophilia. Here's Rabbi Baruch Lachez, who now heads the Lubavitch community in Monsey, New York, and was the top leader at Sydney Chabad for 20 years. In recordings of a recent phone conversation with an individual familiar with child sex allegations against Sydney's Chabad community in the 1980s, Lachez said, "We are speaking about very young boys. Everybody says about the other one that he agreed to this." Chabad Rabbi Manus Friedman compared being molested as a child to having diarrhea. He said, "Do I have to tell my girlfriend that I was molested? Do you have to tell that you once had diarrhea? It's embarrassing, but nobody's business." The Royal Commission asked Chabad Rabbi Yosef Feldman, "Did you understand that it was against the law for an adult to touch the genitals of another child?" "I didn't know that as a fact," he responded. And he was the director of the Yeshiva Corporation and ran a school for decades. Most of the mobsters I've shown in this video are affiliated with Chabad, and they're going to continue to get away with abusing children while Trump is in power. Trump has been surrounded by pedophiles since him and Roger Stone were disciples of Roy Cohn. They didn't do anything about his pedophilia because he made them rich. Yes, pedophiles have been arrested by Trump's DOJ. Every year, pedophiles get caught and arrested, no matter who's president. It's the ones who are tied to organized crime that will remain untouched, unless there's massive public pressure a la Jeffrey Epstein. This narrative that Trump is purging the pedophiles and is going to save the world comes from Zionist disinfo agents, SGT Report and QAnon. Bibi wants to be president of the United States for another 4 years. He needs the alternative media to portray Trump as the savior, even if they have to dog whistle to get your attention. The end more than justifies the means.
Who, you know, the only way you cure that, death, bloodshed. I don't advocate it, but I see that it's really the only answer. And even if I could, I wouldn't turn on you. And I would stop the world for you. You know, I wanna let you know. I'm